private companies.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. At question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, after nearly 20 years, the murderer of Emma Caldwell was finally brought to justice. As well as her murder, Ian Packer was convicted of 33 offences against 22 women committed over three decades. He should have been behind bars years ago. This is what Emma's mother, Margaret Caldwell, told us this morning, speaking via her lawyer, Amar Anwar. They knew it was Ian Packer as far back as 2006, but they gave him the freedom to carry on attacking and raping vulnerable women like my Emma. And Margaret had a message for the First Minister. She said this: if Mr. Yusuf genuinely cares about the victims and my Emma, then he has no other option but to organise an independent public inquiry. And she continued, with respect, what are you waiting for? So will Hamza Yusuf take the opportunity today to immediately announce the establishment of a judge-led inquiry?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I thank Douglas Ross for raising an exceptionally important issue. Let me, first and foremost, give once again my condolences and that of the government to Emma's family, her friends, loved ones, at what will continue to be an extraordinarily difficult time. I want to pay tribute to Margaret Caldwell, Emma's mother, and indeed her family, who tirelessly fought for justice, not just for Emma, but of course for the many other women who have suffered at the hands of Ian Packer. Can I also recognise the important role that journalists have played in this as well? The Sunday Mail, BBC Scotland have played in this case, and the tenacity of the reporters in trying to seek out justice. Yesterday's verdict won't have brought any elation or happiness, I suspect, to Emma's family and to Margaret in particular. But I hope it does give a small, tiny crumb of comfort that justice, to some extent, has been done. But Douglas Ross is right, that justice is far too late. There are some serious failings in this case. Of that, there is no doubt. I wrote and have written to the legal representative of Margaret Caldwell, responded to say that I will, of course, meet with Margaret Caldwell alongside the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, willing to meet with them. In terms of a public inquiry, I was wanting to hear from Margaret Caldwell and, of course, examine and look at the case, not just in more detail, but it's important for me to say there is still an ongoing legal process. Ian Packer does have the right, of course, to appeal, so we have to wait, I think, to some extent, to see what the next stages of that legal process are. But let me be absolutely clear, a judge-led public inquiry is absolutely something we are exploring. It is absolutely not off the table, and is something we're giving very serious consideration to, given the systemic failings of this case.
Douglas Ross.
I agree with almost everything the First Minister said there, but it needs to be more than explored and not off the table. There are, of course, legal routes that still have to be established and finished, but we know there are major failings in this case that will not change, regardless of an appeal. And again, this is what Margaret told us this morning via her legal counsel, Amar Anwar. A judge-led public inquiry that acts without fear or favour, that is the very least my Emma and the many women who spoke up deserve. For far too long, those in the police or Crown who failed us have remained in the shadows. She finished by saying only a judge-led public inquiry will reveal the corruption, the criminality and the motivation. Emma Caldwell's family and many other women who were attacked need answers now, not in another 20 years. They need a free and fearless public inquiry that victims and their families can fully trust. So I think the First Minister does need to say today that he agrees to that judge-led inquiry, and we are calling for that to be led by a judge from out with Scotland. Will he agree to that?
First Minister.
Again, there is not much difference between Douglas Ross and I at all in this regard. I will repeat, I don't rule out a public inquiry. The reason, of course, I'm suggesting that it's important and prudent for me to meet with Margaret Caldwell, to hear directly from her, to hear from her legal representative, And importantly, of course, to also explore and examine what the interaction with any inquiry would be with an ongoing legal process. I hear what Douglas Ross is saying, that if there is to be a judge-led public inquiry, should that be with a judge from outside of Scotland? I think that is worthy of consideration if we get to that position. But let me be absolutely clear, we do not rule out, in fact, it's very firmly on the table, a judge-led public inquiry. As First Minister, it is important that I do consider the ongoing legal process. I do go back to the central point of which there is no disagreement between Douglas Ross and I. Emma and many, many women, at least 21 of which we know of, were subjected to the most horrendous attacks, rape, sexual assault, and of course, in Emma's case, tragic murder by Ian Packer. They were ultimately let down by failings in the justice system and clearly failings from the police service at the time. I do commend the bravery of the many other many women who have come forward to speak bravely about their experiences in the pursuit of justice. So I go back to my central point, Presiding Officer. I will meet with Margaret Caldwell, and will meet with her legal representative. And I am very open to the suggestion, to the idea, to the calls for a judge-led public inquiry.
Douglas Ross.
I really feel the First Minister has to go further. He said in his answer there that people have been let down. There are many failings. We know that. Regardless of any appeal that is still to come, the failings by the police and the Crown are absolutely crystal clear. That's why a judge-led inquiry by someone from out West Scotland is the only option. And it must be the only option on the table. And I think the First Minister just needs to take the opportunity today to agree to that, to announce that. Because an inquiry led by a judge from out West Scotland will get to the bottom of what happened here. Because these were not just mere accidents by Police Scotland or the Crown Office. It seems that evidence was deliberately ignored and suppressed. The truth only emerged after years of campaigning by Emma's family when a former detective, Jerry Gallagher, stepped forward as a whistleblower. He publicly identified Ian Packer as a suspect in the media. It's utterly shocking that the response from the police was to launch a surveillance operation targeting the journalists and the whistleblowers. One of the whistleblowers, Jerry Gallagher, says there must be consequences for those responsible. On that point, does Hamza Yousaf agree?
First Minister.
Well, I do agree that the targeting of not just police officers, but suggestions of targeting of journalists as well is incredibly worrying, incredibly concerning. I go back to the question that Douglas Ross has asked me from the very beginning about a public inquiry. I think if the government is to announce a judge-led public inquiry, which, as I say, is something we are very seriously considering and exploring, it's important for us, if we are to make that announcement, first of all, I think to speak, of course, to Margaret Caldwell, but also to come to this Parliament with the full detail of what any potential public inquiry could look to explore and examine what any potential terms of reference may well look like as well. So I go back to my central point. We are not at all opposing a public inquiry, in fact, very firmly in our consideration in this regard. Douglas Ross is absolutely right. When you look back over the history of this case, it is astonishing some of the allegations that are being made in relation to Police Scotland. It wasn't Police Scotland then, of course, the legacy forces prior to Police Scotland's formation. For me, as a government, let me also just say, to give some level of assurance, that this is why the work around violence against women and girls is so, so important to this very day, and we continue, of course, to ensure that we fund that work. So there are many questions to answer around why Ian Packer was able to evade justice, continued to commit many crimes that he did for so long. So we will seriously consider all of the options that are on the table, including, of course, a judge-led public inquiry, and take on board the suggestion that Douglas Ross has made, that if there is to be a public inquiry, then could we consider a judge out with Scotland?
Douglas Ross.
Emma Caldwell, her grieving family, and Packer's many other victims were betrayed by what was one of Scotland's worst policing scandals. Many questions remain about how this shameful saga, which can only be answered by a fearless, transparent and independent inquiry. I really think that is the only option. We need to know, why did it take so long to charge Ian Packer? Why was he allowed to remain free to attack more women? And who was responsible for allowing him, after multiple interviews, to continue to walk free. So I hope the First Minister can take from this to urgently and immediately meet with Margaret Caldwell and her legal representatives to bring an urgent statement back to this Parliament in a matter of days to finally announce that this government is launching an independent inquiry and it will be led by a judge from outside Scotland.
First Minister.
Officer Douglas Ross is right. There are lots of questions that demand an answer. And the many women who have been failed, Emma Caldwell ultimately failed, but many other women have also been failed by the justice system, by the police forces previously. It is important that they get the answers to the questions that they rightly have. Let me also give some assurance to Douglas Ross. We will seek to meet with Margaret Caldwell and her legal representative urgently, and we will look at the options in front of us and come back urgently too, because as Douglas Ross said, I think in his opening question, women have waited far too long for justice, given the history of this case. So I will perhaps end, Presiding Officer, where I started, which is paying tribute to Margaret Caldwell in particular, but also the many other women who came forward bravely to speak about their experiences, the fearless journalists who, of course, at first unmasked Ian Packer's activities and were tireless in their pursuit for justice. But let me end once again by saying that we will not just meet with Margaret Caldwell, but are very seriously considering the option of a public inquiry.
Thank you. Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A toxic culture of misogyny and corruption meant the police failed so many women and girls who came forward to speak up against Packer. Instead of receiving justice and compassion, they were humiliated, dismissed, and in some instances arrested, whilst the police gifted freedom to an evil predator to rape and rape again. The powerful words of Margaret Caldwell yesterday. And we know that since her daughter Emma's murder in 2005, Ian Packer committed 19 rapes, sexual offences or assaults. Victims who could have been protected if Ian Packer had been properly investigated. I want to push the First Minister on the issue of who would lead any potential inquiry. This injustice has spanned 19 years, and in that time, we have had 5 Lord Advocates and 6 Chief Constables. So does the First Minister agree that for any inquiry, or indeed review, to be truly independent, it requires it to be led by an individual separate and independent from Scotland's criminal justice system?
First Minister.
Well, I think Anna Sarwar, much like Douglas Ross, makes some very important points in this regard. Let me come to a few of them if I can. First and foremost, Anna Sarwar is right. We still in Scotland have a serious problem with misogyny. And I know there's a lot of cross-party consensus around some of the actions that the Scottish Government is taking forward to tackle violence against women and girls. I will hope to bring a debate to this Parliament on the issue of positive masculinity, which in itself is of course designed to try to remove and eradicate some of the toxic behaviours that we see from some young men and boys in our society. So on that point, there is little difference between us on the need to tackle that pervasive issue in our society. In regards to the failure and the timeline of the multiple failures from the justice system in relation to Emma Caldwell's murder, as I said to Douglas Ross, I think there is a strong argument for whichever type of review, or if there is ultimately a judge-led public inquiry, then there is a strong argument that the inquiry is led by somebody out with Scotland. So I don't remove that option from the table. It's very firmly on the table, very firmly a part of our consideration. But as I said to Douglas Ross, there are a few considerations we have to give rapidly, urgently, around the ongoing legal process that is currently still happening. And also, of course, hearing from Margaret Caldwell directly herself. I haven't had that opportunity to do so, of course, waiting for the conclusion of the case in order to meet. But we will give that suggestion that both Douglas Ross and Anna Sarwar have made some serious consideration.
Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, there are many troubling issues with this case. Misogyny, prejudice, and the failure to listen to women coming forward with evidence. And amongst those failures is a wider culture where Scottish institutions too often fight for the reputations rather than be on the side of victims and seek to find the truth. That culture still prevails today. Key breakthroughs in this investigation were only possible because of the work and bravery of journalists investigating leads that officers had ignored. But distressingly, the first response of the police to this vital work was not to look at the flaws in their own investigation, but instead attempt to intimidate and criminalise those journalists. In this case, and today, journalists, victims and campaigners seeking to uncover an injustice in Scotland too often find themselves the victim of intimidation and harassment. Does the First Minister accept that, and what steps is he taking to end this culture?
First Minister.
Well, again, that should not be a culture in any of our institutions, and Anna Sarr will be aware, of course, on the back of the work that Dame Alicia Angelini has done for this government. We have introduced the Police Ethics Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland bill. We introduced that bill, and of course, is making its way through the parliamentary process, and that will improve the police complaints and misconduct process. And again, there's a lot of cross-party consensus, and there'll obviously be some challenge from opposition colleagues, no doubt, for the government to consider going further. But it does have important provisions within that bill to ensure that justice can be pursued even after a police officer retires or indeed resigns. So, as I say, it builds on the significant improvement work that's already been delivered by policing partners since Dame Alicia Angelini's report in November of 2020. So there are things that we can do to improve the culture across our institutions. And again, Anna Sarr, I've often debated around the NHS and the actions the government has taken in relation to ensuring that there's whistleblowing champions, for example. So this government takes seriously the premise of all of our public institutions. It should be, of course, to encourage whistleblowing, to encourage any concerns to come forward, and not to then not for those individuals who raise those concerns to be the ones who are under scrutiny, under pressure, or indeed under any type of intimidation whatsoever. What I would say in relation to violence against women and girls, of course, there is always improvement for Police Scotland to make. That goes almost without saying. But I have seen some comments in the past from organisations who work tirelessly to tackle violence against women and girls, and they have noticed that since the formation of Police Scotland that the investigation of rape and sexual offences has improved. Still room for improvement of that, there's no doubt.
Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While any inquiry will look at the failings in this case over the last 19 years, we know there are issues that persist today. The First Minister has referenced some of that already. In 2020, an independent review of the police complaints and disciplinary system found evidence of misogyny, racism and serious discrimination issues in Police Scotland. And only last year, the outgoing Chief Constable, Ian Livingston, clearly stated that institutional racism, sexism, misogyny and discrimination exist in Police Scotland. And, Presiding Officer, I want to return to the words of Margaret Caldwell. Whatever a woman's job, status, addictions, or vulnerabilities, it should never be used as a reason to ignore sexual violence or treat them as a second-class citizen. Now, whether 19 years ago or today, we know this culture leaves victims unprotected and costs lives. So as a previous Justice Secretary and now as First Minister, how will he end the culture of prejudice and discrimination that denies so many justice?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Anna Sarwar truly for reading out those words, Margaret Caldwell. I think they're incredibly powerful, and I think every single one of us will be moved by her words. She is absolutely right. And there's a lot of work that we are doing. I'm happy to write to Anna Sarwar with, of course, greater details. A lot of work we're doing around our equally safe strategy in particular, but also to frankly challenge men's demand for sex. It's really important that we all recognise that prostitution is a form of violence against women and girls and is completely unacceptable. And our recent published strategy to challenge men's demand for prostitution and actions to support women who are in prostitution outlines a new pilot programme to improve access to support for those with experience of prostitution. And lessons learned from this pilot, piloting the strategy, will help, of course, to inform any legislative consideration, including whether to criminalise or not the purchase of sex. So we have an important job to do within government to support women, regardless of any of their background, any vulnerabilities that they may have. We have, of course, and again, I'll write down that in more detail, taken forward a range of work, again, a lot of it cross-party, to improve victims' experiences within the criminal justice system. Just this week, of course, piloting free court transcripts for victims of rape and sexual offences, which we know a number of campaigners have met with all of us cross-party. So this government will continue to make sure that victims are at the very centre of our justice system, but there are plenty of lessons to learn. And I go back to my initial response to both Douglas Ross and Anna Sauer, presiding officer, that we will meet with Margaret Caldwell, of course, as government. I will meet with Margaret Caldwell, and there is due consideration being given to a judge-led public inquiry.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, presiding officer. May I say that my thoughts today lie with Emma Caldwell's family, and the discussion we've heard just now, I think, underpins that urgent need for a judge-led inquiry. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
Tuesday, Presiding Officer.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, an international study has shown that Scotland is amongst the longest waits and poorest access to cancer treatment. I want to tell the Chamber about Jill. Her mum, dad, cousin, aunt and two grandparents have all died of cancer. Her sister tested positive for the CHEK2 cancer gene and was given preventative surgery and reconstruction in Edinburgh. But Jill was repeatedly denied genetic testing in NHS Glasgow, despite her family history. She persevered and discovered that she does have that gene. Now she is being told that the surgery her sister received in Edinburgh isn't available in Glasgow, meaning far longer waits and recovery times. Presiding Officer, when cancer rips through your family and you know it's coming for you, the last thing you need is to fight for care. All Jill wants to do is to see her young children grow up, something her mother never got to do. So can I ask the First Minister to look into Jill's case and to ensure that all patients, wherever they live, have the highest quality of cancer care?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for raising what was an incredibly important issue, and of course read through the study, the international study that he references. If Alex Cole-Hamilton would, after First Minister's question, send me the details of Jill's case. And can I put on record my sympathy for all the losses that she has experienced? Alex Cole-Hamilton is absolutely right. The only thing many of us want to do is grow up with our children, see our children grow up, spend time with them, and have as much time with our loved ones as possible. So I'm more than happy to look into this case. I can also make sure that we send Alex Cole-Hamilton some of the detail around the improvements that we're making within cancer care. It's still extremely challenging. There's no getting away from that. There's no denying that post-pandemic. But we are seeing more and more people on both the 31-day and the 62-day pathways. And there has been some recent evaluation of our rapid cancer diagnostic services, which may be of interest to Alex Cole-Hamilton, which have shown some really positive results in reducing waiting times for diagnosis for patients in the areas where the rapid cancer diagnostic services operate. So I'll wait for Alex Cole-Hamilton to send Jill's details, if you may, and we'll see what we can do from the government.
Question number four, Emma Harper.
To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the latest figures highlighting the impact of livestock worrying in Scotland.
First Minister.
The worrying of livestock by dogs is completely unacceptable. It's something the Scottish Government does take very seriously, recognising the very serious welfare and indeed financial impacts that livestock worrying can have. The figures quoted indicate that there are still individuals who do not recognise their responsibilities as dog owners and allow their dogs to chase livestock. Ignorance of the law, of course, is no excuse whatsoever. So we welcomed, of course, the introduction of Emma Harper's Dogs Protection of Livestock Scotland Bill, which came into force on the 5th of November 2021, and I thank her for her continued efforts in this area. Education is a key factor in the prevention of livestock worrying incidents. The Scottish Outdoor Access Code is clear on the rights and responsibilities of land managers and of those exercising access rights, which is widely published.
Emma Harper.
I thank the First Minister for that response. My Dogs Protection of Livestock 2021 Act has proved successful in raising awareness of livestock attacks and worrying and in encouraging farmers to have the confidence to report livestock worrying incidents. However, NFU Mutual's latest report on rural crime shows that livestock worrying reports are increasing. Stakeholders, including the NFUS and Land and Estates, have called for a change to the Outdoor Access Code to mandate that dogs be kept on leads when in fields where livestock is present. So can the First Minister comment both on how the government can continue to raise awareness of My Livestock Warning Act and also on whether it will consider making such an amendment to the Outdoor Access Code as part of the upcoming Land Reform Bill?
First Minister.
I think all those points made by Emma Harper are well worthy of consideration. She's absolutely right to highlight the difference made by the legislation this Parliament enacted on livestock worrying, thanks mainly to her efforts in bringing the bill forward and guiding it into law. It's interesting to note that only now is the UK government proposing to legislate similarly to cover England too. We continue to work with partners to increase awareness of dog owners' responsibilities under the Livestock Worrying Act, including through Nature Scots' traditional and social media activity on responsible dog walking, but I've also asked the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity to consider what more we might do to raise awareness and encourage more responsible ownership and owner behaviour, especially at times like the lambing season. I note that some would wish us to review the Access Code, as Emma Harper references, and of course we'll give that consideration, but I think we can be quite rightly proud here in Scotland that we have some of the most open access to our land anywhere, and as a nation, we do want that to continue. Closing off the countryside certainly isn't the answer here, and certainly not what Emma Harper is suggesting at all. We want to encourage more people to follow and adhere to the Scottish Outdoor Access Code, especially in relation to responsible dog walking.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The devastating cost of dog attacks on livestock has doubled in Scotland since 2022. It's causing harm and distress to animals and financial hardship to farmers. The legislation really isn't working, is it, First Minister?
First Minister.
Well, I think there are a number of reasons why we've seen some of the incidents rise. What I would say to Rachel Hamilton is she's suggesting that the legislation isn't working. Of course, the UK government are looking to legislate for England in a very similar manner. Indeed, and we're happy to share any information with the UK government on the legislation we've brought forward here. I think we have to make sure that we're doing more to raise awareness of course, responsible dog walking when it comes to, right across the year, but when it comes to particular seasons such as the lambing season. But Rachel Hamilton is right, the impacts of livestock worrying are significant. They're traumatic often to farmers, of course, to the livestock indeed, but also cause significant financial hardship. That's why we'll do what we can to make sure that we tackle livestock worrying wherever it's happening in Scotland.
Question number 5, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to prevent convicted sex offenders from changing their identity.
First Minister.
This is a matter of public protection, which we take extremely seriously. All registered sex offenders are subject to sex offender notification requirements, and any change of name must, by law, be notified to the police. The management of offenders' documents include recording of any aliases. We became aware before Christmas that the UK government were working on legislative changes on name changes within their criminal justice bill, and we're very keen to align arrangements where possible, which is why we may have made repeated requests at ministerial and official level to see the detail of proposed amendments. I'm pleased we received these amendments, but only this week. So we've therefore started the serious and careful consideration needed to examine how they would work in Scotland and to the tight deadlines of the UK legislation.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the First Minister for his response? He will share my concern about news reports at the weekend about an individual with convictions for sexual assault of children who changed his name and was then appointed president of the World Robert Burns Federation, where he had access to children participating in Burns competitions. And there are many other similar cases involving individuals whose convictions predated the creation of the sex offenders register. It's clearly a very serious issue which potentially puts at risk children from predatory adults able to conceal their offending history by changing their names. So as the First Minister said, the UK government are proposing changes in the law to protect children in these circumstances. He referred to work that's ongoing. Can he give us some assurance as to how quickly the Scottish government can move to close this loophole in the law that otherwise might be very dangerous?
First Minister.
Can I thank Murdo Fraser for raising this issue? I was extremely concerned at press reports on the weekend of the particular case that Murdo Fraser references. I can give him an absolute assurance. We are working hard to see how we can work with the UK government to align some of the changes that they're proposing here in Scotland. I of course understand the public's concern around this issue, and we'll always consider what changes we can make to ensure there are effective safeguards in place where it is within our legislative competence to do so. Murdoch will be more than aware, of course, that passports, driver licence and name changes related to them are reserved to the UK government, as we've just referenced. There are other ways that people can change their name, for example, when marrying, divorcing, making a statutory declaration, using the middle names rather than the first names, so on and so forth. So we'll have to consider all of these issues in the round. If there's anything that we can do within our gift, we will prepare to work with the UK government, as Murdo Fraser asks, with urgency.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Can the First Minister provide an update on other measures to manage sex offenders, including licence, behavioural or prevention orders, and how they link with notification conditions, and if these have been updated?
First Minister.
An important question from Audrey Nicholl, because there will be a lot of concern after the press reports on the weekend of the case that Murdo Fraser referenced in his question. But it is important to try to give some reassurance that new behavioural orders were introduced last year to reinforce what were already stringent checks on individuals who pose a risk of sexual harm. With sexual harm prevention orders, the police can apply to courts for individuals convicted of sexual offending where it's believed that they do pose a risk of sexual harm to the public. Where granted, the individual will automatically become subject to the sex offender notification requirements. The sexual risk order is a civil preventative order designed to protect the public from sexual harm. There's no need for a previous conviction. Breach of either of these orders can result in imprisonment. License conditions, of course, can also be put in place to manage behaviour on release from custody. They can be monitored by Justice Social Work and electronically monitored if deemed necessary. We do have, of course, as Audrey Nicholl will be very aware, a very stringent MAPA requirements placed on offenders as well. And in Scotland, the vast majority of registered sex offenders do comply with the notification requirements imposed upon them, in fact 93%, according to the MAPA annual report published in October last year. But as I said to Murdo Fraser previously, that if there is more that we can do, whether it's within our own competence or working with the UK government to safeguard, particularly our children, but safeguard individuals from predatory behaviour, then of course we'll seek to work with whoever we have to ensure those safeguards in place.
Question number 6, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reports that the number of people living in temporary accommodation in Glasgow had increased by 25%.
First Minister.
Statistics published on Tuesday show the challenges that we face in tackling homelessness. This only highlights the challenge we face. This highlights the challenge we face in tackling homelessness, but is compounded undoubtedly by the cost of living crisis, the impact of UK austerity, economic repercussions of the pandemic, which are all driving up homelessness presentations. The Home Office's streamlined asylum process is also impacting local authorities, particularly Glasgow, creating increased demands for homelessness services. The Scottish Government is doing what we can within the powers and indeed the financial constraints we have to mitigate the impact and reduce the number of people in temporary accommodation. We're providing record funding of more than £14 billion to councils in 24-25, a real terms increase of 4.3%. Compared to the current financial year. The Minister for Housing has been meeting with housing conveners to discuss homelessness and housing pressures.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. And the report he's referring to, which I assume he's read, also says that the Scottish Government report stated that a lack of affordable housing options is partly to blame for the rise in the number of children seeking temporary accommodation. So can I ask the First Minister, why did he vote for a £196 million cut to the affordable housing budget on the same day that the government published a report blaming a lack of that type of housing as a cause for the hike in the number of children in temporary accommodation?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the government has a strong record in building affordable housing, in fact, building record levels of affordable housing. In fact, we have a good record when it comes to tackling the money that we provide for tackling homelessness. In the budget, for example, investing £90 million in discretionary housing payments in 24-25. That's an increase of over £6 million from this financial year. It also includes, of course, £74 million to mitigate the bedroom tax. Yeah. It's something, of course, that Sir Keir Starmer wants to retain, Presiding Officer. Yeah. And, of course, we know, if we look at independent analysis from crisis,
that austerity-driven policies are undoubtedly driving up homelessness right across the country, including, for example, the two-child limit. So the reality is, I would say to Pam Duncan Glancy, that our budget is facing a conservative cut of £1.6 billion to our capital budget, a £290 million cut to financial transactions, which of course are crucial for house building. Wouldn't it be so much better, Presiding Officer, that Scotland wasn't at the mercy of cruel Westminster governments cutting our budget, but we could raise our own revenue, make spending decisions in our own country's interest, as opposed to having to battle 14 years of austerity and a cost of living crisis worse than we've ever seen in our living memories, Presiding Officer.
Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At the very end of last year, the Scottish Housing Regulator published updated engagement plans for Glasgow and Edinburgh councils. The regulator found systemic failure in the delivery of services to people experiencing homelessness. So could I therefore ask the First Minister, what has the Scottish Government done to help address these failures and prevent them in the future?
First Minister.
Well, Presiding Officer, again, I go back to that independent analysis by stakeholders like Crisis, which say, of course, that the austerity-driven policies of the UK government is what driving homelessness, unfortunately, increasing homelessness to the figures that we have seen, not just in Glasgow, but I'm afraid right across the UK. So we will continue to invest in discretionary housing payment. We'll continue to do what we can to mitigate the worst excesses of the UK government. We'll put £35 million for specific action to end homelessness and rough sleeping where we can. But I go back to the point that I was making to Pam Duncan Glancy, Presiding Officer. The Conservatives have cut our budget, capital budget, or threatening to cut it, by £1.6 billion over the next 5 years. They've cut financial transactions by 62%, which are crucial, of course, to the affordable housing supply programme. So if Annie Wells wanted to have any influence whatsoever, instead of, I think, raising these issues here, which she has every right to do, she could use the influence amongst her own party colleagues to demand that that Tory cut is reversed to our budget. And, of course, not only that, that the 14 years of austerity that they have imposed upon Scotland is halted and halted immediately, Presiding Officer.
Move to general and constituency supplementaries. If we can be concise, we'll have more members contributing. And I call John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the First Minister will be aware that Police Scotland are investigating the suspected murder of Brian Lowe in Aberfeldy in my constituency on the 17th of February. And I take this opportunity to express my sympathy to Mr Lowe's family at this terrible tragedy. Does the First Minister recognise this awful incident has caused deep unease in the community that I represent, and that there is a need for full transparency from Police Scotland over the handling of this case? And does the First Minister also believe it is vital that all resources are applied to bring to justice anyone involved, and that Police Scotland need to maintain the necessary presence locally to assure the community I represent of its safety at this incredibly worrying time?
First Minister.
I agree with all of that. Can I start, of course, by giving my condolences to the family, friends, loved ones of Brian Lowe? And can I also ensure that I give as much reassurance as I possibly can to the community of Aberfeldy, who are rightly shocked, rocked, in fact, by this tragic incident. I will, of course, have to be careful what I say. It's a live murder investigation, and of course, is ongoing. But let me try to give as much reassurance as I can to the community of Aberfeldy about their safety. I know that Police Scotland will be taking this case, are taking this case, extremely seriously. There are questions, I know, that have been asked, given media reports in the last 48 hours in terms of the time taken between Mr Lowe's death and the post-mortem and the opening of the murder investigation. I've been absolutely assured, and I've sought these assurances, that Police Scotland are working around the clock into this murder investigation and will be seeking to reassure the community as they can. And I think the suggestion being made about an increased police presence is a sensible suggestion being made by Mr Swinney, and I'll ensure that's fed back through my office to Police Scotland. Well, these issues are, of course, at the behest of the operational independence of the Chief Constable, I think it's a very sensible suggestion as well. And it should be said that Police Scotland have been appealing to any member of the public who may have any information to come forward. Anybody who is travelling through that area who may have, for example, dash cam footage, to contact the police. And that can be done, of course, anonymously through Police Scotland's online portal as well. But I go back to the point that John Swinney was rightly raising around reassurances from the community. I'll raise that with Police Scotland, but I'm certain Police Scotland will do everything in their powers to provide reassurance to the community of Aberfeldy.
Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Monday, up to half of the North East ambulance fleet, that's 18 ambulances, were stuck outside Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. A paramedic told the Press and Journal they are unable to help those most in need because they're repeatedly tied up. And the situation is now so bad that earlier this month, a shop worker in Dyce, who was covered in blood after being attacked and left almost unconscious by robbers, had to be driven to hospital by her employer because the ambulance service was too busy. First Minister, what immediate action will the Scottish Government take to address the ongoing crisis across the North East? Thank you.
First Minister.
Tess White is right to raise this issue. The level of ambulance stacking, the waits, the turnaround times at the ARI in particular are simply not acceptable. And I'm afraid there is no reason that can justify that level of wait. So I have been extremely concerned about the reports that we've heard from paramedics directly. I'm more than happy for the Cabinet Secretary for Health to write to Tess White. I'm sure he does write to Tess White with the full details of the conversations that we're having with Grampian and about some of the actions that they are taking. They are looking at, for example, doing more to increase discharge planning to maintain patient flow, increase alternative care pathways for ambulance clinicians to support patients in the community as opposed to coming to ARI. ARI have also, NHS Grampian have also ensured that they're expanding the site's acute capacity and they've recently opened 32 new acute beds at the Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, so therefore increasing the capacity that will help with inpatient flow through ARI and hopefully help the issue of ambulance stacking. But this is a very serious issue indeed. I'm not happy at all, I have to say, about the continued long ambulance turnaround times at the ARI in particular, and I'll ensure the Cabinet Secretary for Health writes to Tess White with full details of the actions that have been taken forward.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I remind members of my register of voluntary interests. Members of the RMT union are rallying outside Parliament today against a £350 million cut to Scotland's safety-critical rail infrastructure spending. They say rail cuts cost lives. 70 frontline maintenance workers have just been made redundant. A further 80 jobs are now at risk. So which is correct? The government's assertion to Parliament that rail infrastructure spending is rising, or the view of experienced railway workers out there in the real world on the front line, supported by all the empirical evidence that Scotland's rail infrastructure budgets and jobs are being axed, and that as a result, the health and safety of workers and passengers is being put at risk?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we of course as a government and the Cabinet Secretary for Transport will have regular engagement with rail trade unions, including of course the RMT. What I would say of course is that rail infrastructure is rising. The investment in rail infrastructure is rising, as the Cabinet Secretary for Transport has already outlined. We do appreciate and share the RMT's views that rail safety should absolutely be prioritised. However, we don't agree with their assertion that rail funding, rail infrastructure funding is being cut. So we'll continue to meet regularly with the trade unions. And my understanding is the Cabinet Secretary wrote recently to the RMT to address some of the assertions that they were making in previous correspondence. So we'll continue to engage where we can and, of course, continue to make sure that rail safety for not just our staff, that is crucial, of course, but also for those who use the rail network, that safety continues to be an utmost priority for this government.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, disturbances at HMP and YO Stirling continue almost daily and are having a serious detrimental effect on residents and the local community. The Prison Service have attempted to consult and rectify the situation, but nothing implemented to date has made any significant or lasting difference. Residents believe the prison is out of control. Therefore, what further action can the Scottish Government take and the Cabinet Secretary to support the residents and the vulnerable inmates in this prison?
First Minister.
Well, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs continues to engage on this issue, both with the prison service, but my understanding is I think she's met with Alexander Stewart as well. I would take some exception at the suggestion that the estate is out of control. I wouldn't agree to that assertion whatsoever. We do know that for the actions that were taken, there was a slightly quieter period over Christmas, but there has been incidents, we know, in the last couple of weeks, which have rightly and understandably caused concern to residents as well. There is an action plan in place, and I'll ensure that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice engages again with Alexander Stewart in order to give an update on the actions that are being taken forward in this regard.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Paul Sweeney, and there'll now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so.